put off by how long this video is, don't worry, I try to jam-pack my videos with as much content and as much detail as I possibly can. Anything I feel I can comment on and that I feel you might be interested in, I pretty much put in the video. I try not to repeat myself and talk fairly fast. If the video is too long for you, I have recorded a shorter version and the link will be in the description box. Killing Floor video game review. Don't let the name throw you. It's not really a floor, it's more of a steel grating that allows the material to sluice through and be collected for export. I am reviewing the main game only, not any of the DLC. London, complete with accents and slang. A biotech corporation has run tests on a number of people, leading to specimens, as they're called here. We're just gonna call them zombies, Zeds. People have been grotesquely mutated and disfigured. The government sends whatever military and assorted, like SWAT, which it's not called in England, but whatever, and such, and those are who you play as, in order to kill as many of the specimens and try to restore order. Yeah, this really doesn't have much of a plot, and one reviewer noted that when in Left 4 Dead, it always feels like you're going somewhere, doing something. Here it is, basically just, he says deathmatch, I say team deathmatch, but whatever, it's a series of team deathmatch, you know, matches, yes, with the computer controlling one side, and that is very true. It's a lot of shooting with very little real variation, but I will also get to the positives. This was given to me as a gift, and I have not played the second, and I don't really intend to. And if you don't get any DLC, there's basically one skin you can choose, and there's a little variation depending on the perk you choose for that, excuse me, for that skin, but nevertheless, it is the one skin. This is a six-player cooperative post-apocalyptic survival horror game, first-person shooter, and like Red Orchestra, this started as a mod for Unreal Tournament 2004, you know, back in 05, and where Red Orchestra was then released in 06, this was released in 09, with the Unreal Engine 3 having come out in 06. They basically, it's because of the license fee that they didn't go with that one, but it does mean that right from the start, this was dated by 2 years. And as others have noted, it's very polished for a mod, but not quite enough for a standalone. But like both Red Orchestra games, this does have a lot of tactics to it, tactical gameplay. This one doesn't have vehicles, unlike those two, which is fine. There's, you know, not every team deathmatch game needs vehicles, and it wouldn't really fit that well into what we have here. But you don't have to play it stealthy, you don't have to worry about unseen distant enemies, you don't respawn, you know, seconds later, you respawn at the end of a wave. This doesn't go for this really kind of extreme level of accuracy and realism and, like, you know, period accuracy and such. The HUD is easy to read right from the start, and much, you know, actually, you know, tells you all the things. These aren't criticisms of Red Orchestra. But, yeah, and this also does not have, like, a lot of functions and a lot of keys you have to memorize. Okay, that one maybe is a criticism. sometimes matches do boil down to just the team kind of camping or using a map exploit, but honestly, I didn't really find that that was too, you know, the case too much. Others have noted this doesn't really do a lot to set the mood. This has real dark sense of humor, and it's fairly funny when it really, you know, not like all-out comedy game, but it has, yeah, it has a sense of a very dark sense of humor, and it is badass more than scary. It's gruesome, brutal, gory, violent. You know, you've got body parts being taken off, you know, enemies explode, you know, some enemies explode when killed. Certainly you can blow them up. It's quite intense, and it is utterly drenched in testosterone. It's a very over-the-top first-person shooter. Some say kind of standard, and to some extent, but nevertheless, it's quite fun. And it's a lot like Counter-Strike, just with, you know, one side being controlled by the computer and that side being, you know, these very specific zombies. But yeah, this is very much the offspring of Doom, and really, to an extent, you could say, I mean, this is basically, it's Doom, but with, like, really cool weapons. Okay, it's Doom with, like, really memorable levels. Doom with a great kick-ass soundtrack. Doom with really gloomy settings. Doom with dark comedy. Doom with no plot. Co-op. Doom didn't originally have co-op. And so, in order, it's one of the most metal games ever. You know, these dark ambiances, heavy, groovy guitar riffs. And when you fight off the Zeds, there's an actual counter for how many are left. So you can always see how far. And this does get to, you know, reach over, well over 100. Like, yeah, in some of the later waves. So yeah, there's plenty of killing to go around. And there is no actual time limit to waves. It is purely based on killing the zombies. So, you know, even a match with a few hundred, if all six players really, you know, if part of it is also sometimes the zombies kind of get stuck or forget how to get to where they're going and such, but yeah, if it's going really well, it can take like 2 to 5 minutes for, you know, 180 zombies to be murdered by you. And, you know, other times it can take longer, but yeah. Now, unlike Left 4 Dead, this does not have the, you know, really dynamic, the AI director, which really controls level pacing and different spawn points and such. And really, yeah, this one, the pace is fairly, it basically does have the one, like, it gets increasingly more intense as you play through the waves, but it doesn't really go, like, it just grand, you know, it moves from 0 to 100 in the time that it takes to get through the match, but it doesn't really go up or down along the way Left 4 Dead does. And there, you know, when you've completed the full amount of waves, that, you know, there's short, medium, and long game, which respectively are 4 waves, 7 waves, or 10 waves, but you can also set it, you know, custom. After you've completed all of those, you will face the boss, the Patriarch, who's basically the scientists who did all these tests, because as we know, you know, dark sci-fi horror where a scientist is doing some testing, eventually he's gonna test it on himself. So and it's kind of cool design. Like he's got these very like dorky scientist glasses, but then one of his eyes is like really sticking out, and he's got like these tentacle kind of things coming out of his stomach, and yeah, you know, minigun rockets, yeah. And I want to say the minigun is on his arm, but it's been a few days since I really looked at his design in detail. But yeah, and he is a very threatening sort. He, you know, he threatens, "I will show you all my extensive Pokemon collection." The and you know, he'll threaten, you know, you'll pay, you'll all pay with interest. And you see where he spawns, and it will often be close to you. And of course, if you don't know the level that well, you may not recognize where he spawns, but yeah. And if you wound him but don't quite kill him, he might, you know, turn around and run off. And this is very deliberately animated to make him look significantly less dangerous than he seemed just a few seconds ago. And you know, then he may have just told you, "You'll pay for what you did to my children," and then when he runs away, he'll say, "My children, protect me." So yeah, you know, hypocrisy is often a fun trait in a villain. And he can turn invisible to, you know, try to get closer to you or to try to get away. Something that helps a lot with spotting him is if you manage to set him on fire, because then there will, the fire isn't invisible, so you just see this flame kind of, like, even if a character is only, you know, yeah, if they're just quote unquote just on fire, you'll see this little flame sticking out, like, I guess, yeah, it's like their back, kind of, yeah. Is that like a flame out of the, is it Terrence and Philip, maybe? Anyway, yeah, moving on, the others have noted the sound effects are like okay. Some of them can get really repetitive. The, you know, actual video game critics' reviews are about half and half on this, but user reviews are like overwhelmingly positive. And this is one of those cases where, yeah, you have, like, excuse me, the critics will point to, the way I see it, critics of, you know, film or video game or book or whatever, they're always trying to say, what does this do that, like, sets it apart from everything that's come before? Or, like, yeah, you know, things like that, where a lot of, you know, when I turn off my critic senses and just want to enjoy something, yeah, it's like, you know, yeah, it might not be the best thing ever, but it's a lot of fun, you know, it's really enjoyable. And with this, yeah, you know, the critics point out the graphics are dated, it's, you know, it's definitely not Left 4 Dead, but it does have some things that Left 4 Dead definitely doesn't. And yeah, you know, if those points don't put you off, there's a lot of fun to be had here. And some have said that, you know, if Left 4 Dead is a Hollywood movie, this is like a made-for-TV movie, and yeah, that's a decent way to put it. Some have said it's kind of generic and repetitive. I think after a while it starts to feel that way, but yeah, you know, if the thing is, yeah, you know, if it's like Counter-Strike and it's like just a series of team deathmatch sessions. If you know, it's Counter-Strike with one team being computer-controlled zombies. If that appeals to you, then this probably is going to be something that you enjoy. There's a, yeah, you know, and that's also, I think, the some of the people who don't really, yeah, if that's just not your thing, then this isn't really for you. Where, like, if you, even if you're not the you know, a huge fan of this sort of thing, you know, playing Left 4 Dead, there might be some things that are like, oh, that's kind of cool, that's kind of funny. And in this, yeah, it's all focused on just this kind of thing. And yeah, you know, and the thing about being metal, that reviewer hits it right on the head. If you're not into that, then this is definitely not going to be for you. But if you are, then yeah, this really is, yeah, a ton of fun. Now, something I really appreciate about this, that, you know, this is also true of Contagion, but unlike Left 4 Dead, this doesn't have, you know, movement isn't like slow and kind of loose and bouncy. I understand it's because of the engine for that, but that is where, like, it's much less of, yeah, I'd say I find it less frustrating in Portal. Not frustrating at all, but less. When you have to move very quickly and precisely, yeah, that's really frustrating. And this does have some light RPG elements, and like Left 4 Dead, you know, characters will automatically yell out when they're reloading. This, it's very easy to configure this for, you know, how many matches you want, and just really, really straightforward for that. And it also has, you know, really extensive, and, you know, they come, it's, yeah, the modding tools. And you can see, I will get into the mods a little later, but yeah, like, if you're looking at this and thinking, well, it looks okay, but there's not that much variety to, like, sounds, music, levels, the appearance of things, there are a ton of different variations on those via the mods. It's really just the core gameplay is what remains intact in almost all of this. And yeah, if you're into that, then this is going to be for you, and if not, then yeah. And if at least one player survives, you know, until the end of a wave, or yeah, you will just respawn after that wave has concluded. And this is also, if even one player survives and kills the patriarch, that also means that the, you know, it then says your squad survived. You know, that counts as everyone winning the level. And the amount of zombies fits the amount of players. And there is this feature called Zed time, which is basically slow-mo for, you know, especially cool kills and such. And like I said of Rack, I like it, but I wish it was based on how much damage you do in a short space of time. And, you know, for this especially, I kind of wish that it was more of a, like, it would say something that, like, how Unreal Tournament, it's been forever since I played Unreal Tournament, but I'm for sure it was in the 99. If you would rack up kills, like, you know, kill two people in a very short space of time, double kill, some more multi-kill, eventually monster kill, if it did that, but for how much damage you do. But the slow motion, you know, opinions are mixed on it. I'm not the biggest fan of it myself, but it is very useful for just doing a real quick 360 degree turn, checking on all of your allies, their health, their position, and such. And this has gibbing, although, you know, taking limbs off doesn't mean, you know, unlike Contagion, they're not going to be, you know, really slowed down by it or even made to crawl. And gibbing is much less cool than in Left 4 Dead 2. Some have encountered bugs. I haven't really, but there are a few minor glitches. Sometimes when going around menus, such as when you're looking at the list of servers and when you're in the store, basically when you're looking at a list of servers, if you change the difficulty, which I sometimes did to see how many matches there were of the different difficulties, you kind of have to, once you select the difficulty, you basically have to go back out of that menu, then into it, then click refresh before it properly refreshes. And the bigger, although again not huge, frustration with glitch is the store glitch, where basically if you click between a few different things you can buy or sell, then it won't, at some point it'll maybe stop highlighting the buy or sell button. And the fix is simple. You just click to one of the other things you can buy or sell, then click back to the one. But this does cost you a few seconds. You don't know when it's going to happen. And if you didn't have a lot of time in the store, this might mean that you don't have time to buy or sell the thing or things that, yeah, that's a bit annoying. Now, there are a few different modes with this. Killing floor mode is basically just the basic one. There's no real bells or whistles on that one. And if you play a long match of 10 waves, it can take around 30 minutes. But like I said, sometimes it takes much less. It depends on, you know, the skill level and how well the team works together and such. There's a mode called Gun Game Mode, which is team deathmatch, but without zombies on it. And if you play it in solo, it will have a, you know, AI both on your team and the other team, which is entirely unlike I played a lot of solo in this, and at no point was there even a single, you know, official levels included. There are no co-op, you know, AI co-op partners for that. But yeah, the gun game mode, every time you kill someone, you get the next gun in you know, in line, and you get to keep that when you die. And this, you know, yeah, this goes for every single player, and you win by getting to the top level, getting the very best gun. And it's a lot of fun. It really changes in dynamic along the way, because the fact that you have a higher level gun doesn't mean that it's, you might say, as easy to kill with as the gun you had just before. You know, an explosive weapon, for example, if you're at the right range and you can angle it right and everything, it's going to be real easy to kill the enemy with. But then you might, you know, next find that you have just, you know, a powerful weapon, but a slow one that's, you know, that's maybe not explosive. So, yeah, it's a lot of fun, that mode. And I found 9 maps, really it was 5, and then, you know, 4 variations on some of those. And it does not auto team balance, which is a little frustrating. And there is objective mode. I should note, the gun game mode, as far as I've been able to tell, that is specifically a mod mode. That's not one that comes with the game if you don't download any of the mods. Which, you know, if you don't know, they are free. They are entirely, you know, the DLC you have to pay for, but there's no, yeah, you can spend, excuse me, forever trying out all the different mods. You can spend, you know, you can do none of them. Either way, it's not going to cost you anything. So, yeah, you can go nuts with that. And yeah, the moving on to objective mode. This is basically like an action adventure kind of game, you know, also fitting in with the rest of the genres. That it's, you know, basically you have to find and use specific items to proceed. Like, you know, okay, so here's the door, now we have to find the key. Or, you know, okay, now you have to weld this particular thing, you know, you have to go here and weld this particular thing, and then you have to keep it welded for so and so long. You know, yeah, it's that kind of thing, and it really adds a lot of, like, you know, a lot of variation and kind of, yeah, more dynamic feel to. And this is, you know, that is actually an area where this is more complex than Left 4 Dead, and in a number of ways it is, but that is, like, you know, that's closer to Contagion, which nevertheless does beat this in that regard. I can understand, like, if we are talking like technical side, then yeah, this is better than Contagion. And the, you know, in objective mode, I found, you know, 5 levels. The 4 of them were actually made by Tripwire Interactive, who made this game as well. And it's cool how, you know, there's a little story, there's, you know, it's kind of the typical kind of thing of there's a voice telling you what you have to do, and it's a character who's maybe trapped in the area, or who in some way or another can help you, or maybe they try to trick you and send zombies after you, and, you know, but yeah, and the stories are pretty decent, and the characters are also decent. And all of them, of course, fit into the overall world of, you know, it's still you're running around London and trying to help, you know, trying to kill zombies wherever you can. And yeah, then you find these, you know, these specific places where there's one person, you know, calling out for your help and such. And yes, there is at least one escort mission, so yeah. And you know, you can play solo offline, and yeah, as others have noted, it's much less fun than playing with others, but it is also the place where you have the easiest time of playing all the different mods and levels that you know that you specifically want, because otherwise you do have to look for servers or start a server and invite people or the like. And I should note, there are plenty of servers both with like mods and levels, and there are a ton of vanilla servers as well. Now, some enemies are, you know, move relatively fast, some even move faster than you. And the various types, there's the clot, which is the basic type, very, you know, straightforward, but they can really mob you, and they have this, they can basically grab you and hold you still, which makes it a lot easier for them to really claw through you, and a lot harder for you to get away from them. So yeah, don't let them get close to you, especially if there are just a few of them, because they, yeah. Before I get too much into, I do want to say that the enemies could be a lot more varied here. It is basically the first person shooter, you know, thing of you know, tough enemies of, well, this guy's, you know, he has a lot of health and he can do a lot of damage, and that's, yeah, that's basically it. And you know, where a lot of other first person shooters supplement that with more varied like designs and such, this doesn't really have that. And again, it really, if you're not really into this sort of thing, you're not gonna find it that interesting. And again, that is unlike the Left 4 Dead, you know, both Left 4 Dead games. But yeah, there is this invisible one called the Stalker, which it becomes visible when, you know, when it attacks, you can tell where it is. And you know, they do make a little bit of sound, of noise, and you can kind of tell like the shimmer when they're fairly close. And then there's this the one called the crawler, which is agile and spider-like, and it is apparently like an arachnid mixed with a human. And then yeah, you know, the gore fast and does a lot of damage. The skrake, some of the same, in the flesh pound, some of the same. Excuse me. Then there's the bloat, which vomits this bile at you, which does damage. And which, you know, it kind of, it does lasting damage. And the husk, which has this fireball kind of, you know, gun. And the siren, which screams, and the screams can do damage. They can cause a little bit of like disorientation, you know, the effects of that. And it negates explosives. So if you, yeah, anything explosive, it just goes poof with the scream, and that's, yeah, that makes her incredibly dangerous, especially when she's like in a crowd, which she often is, and you're trying to blow up that crowd. But yeah, you know, ultimately these are fairly bland and boring, and it's so surprising because they show in the event ones that they clearly know how to make really cool and memorable ones. And I mean, those are really just reskins. It's the same enemies. It's just, yeah, the appearance. And yeah, and you know, when you compare it to Left 4 Dead, you know, Left 4 Dead 2, even Left 4 Dead 1, they're just, yeah, they're especially bland and boring. And it's just, they're really all, pretty much all humanoid. They're fairly, you know, they don't vary that much in size. Like, there's nothing as tiny as the jockey in this or as huge as the tank. And yeah, the enemies just don't. The way they attack and such, they don't change the dynamic the same. Again, it's just, okay, this guy's really, you know, he takes a lot of damage and he does a lot of damage. We have to keep him away. And yeah, that's basically it. Very few of them even have ranged attacks. You know, as a brief, like, in Left 4 Dead, let's just go directly to Left 4 Dead 2, but starting with the Left 4 Dead 1 ones, you know, you've got the hunter which jumps onto one of the players and holds them there. I'm talking about when it works. You know, if you're doing everything right, then hopefully you manage to shoot any of these before they do these things. But yeah, you've got the smoker which, you know, grabs one of them by the neck from afar with his tongue and, you know, starts to choke him again. Just, you know, all of these incapacitate hold the player in place, and if they take enough damage, incapacitate them. You know, you've got the boomer which, when, you know, if it vomits onto you or when it explodes, the goo from it attracts a ton of other zombies. And you know, this is a huge problem. If the four players are close together and they all get hit by this, yeah, that's a huge, you know, switch between, conversely, if none of them get hit with it, or if only one of them does. You know, you have the witch. That's, you know, that's really the one that there is of, like, that's a lot like the more powerful zombies here. You know, if she gets close to you and she really lets loose, you know, she's really fast and she does a lot of damage, and it takes a lot to take her down. But then, you know, on the surface, the tank sounds like basically the same thing, but the tank can actually, in a very short space of time, incapacitate the entire team. You know, he can smack the, you know, player so he goes flying, and if there's like water nearby or a steep drop, then yeah, he might die from that. You know, he'll bash a tank, a vehicle, you know, onto the players. You know, he'll break a piece of the ground off and throw it at them, and just, you know, this hugely changes the dynamic of how you're playing when one or more tanks enter the... I suppose that is it for the first games. Yes, and so, you know, with the second one, they also introduced the jockey, which can actually guide the player slightly and, again, take him right over an edge or, you know, into boomer bile. And, you know, you've got the charger, which, you know, bowls right through the entire team if he can, and grabs the last one he hits and starts smacking him into the ground, which, yeah, again, hugely, you know, affects the current situation. And finally, the spitter, which, you know, you could say that her attack and the bloat's attack are essentially the same, but the spitter can attack from much further away and actually does like area of effect damage. She, you know, she covers a small section of the ground or floor in this stuff, and then you have to avoid that, which might mean going closer to other zombies or going away from a place that was otherwise safe. And just, yeah, these really change the dynamic, and I don't really feel like this doesn't have, you know, that kind of, because it doesn't want to. I mean, both are supposed to be, you have to constantly be careful, you have to, you know, be carrying the right gun, be shooting the right place, and such. Like, for comparison, Contagion barely has it. Really, it only has the one, you know, special zombie, and that zombie is just one that, it's, you know, you have to shoot at it for longer before it dies. Otherwise, it's essentially the same as the rest. I'm not sure it even moves faster than the rest of them. In that, the focus is on always making sure the, you know, even a single zombie can very quickly completely ruin it for everyone. So there, you're constantly worrying about every single zombie. You're counting every bullet. You know, you basically have to go for headshots, and you're always looking for weapons and ammo and such. And yeah, you know, when I play Contagion, I'm not like, where are the special zombies, special infected, you know. But in this, yeah, kind of, because yeah, the enemies more or less just blend together in this gray mass of, okay, watch out, if that one gets close to you, they can move fast, and they do a lot of damage, and they are also really well armored. But yeah, you know, they basically all walk on, you know, almost all walk on two legs. There's not a lot of color to them, and that, again, like, you can, you know, obviously you do need to, if they're like brightly colored or something, it can be really distracting. It might not fit. But then, you know, the tank is like flesh colored, and like you can see the tank from very far away. And if, yeah, you know, you might think that that made him, you know, that makes him harder to take seriously, because he is not, like, you know, quite as darkly colored as the rest. But yeah, and you know, the spitter, you know, I guess not really her herself, but she emits this fairly bright green kind of, you know, same as her spit is. And yeah, these help a lot in being able to tell, you know, what are we facing very quickly and from far away. And yeah, honestly, Dead Island fares better than this as well. You know, that game basically took the bloke from here. That's it. That's Doom. This is like Doom without creative monster designs. And unlike Left 4 Dead, they don't really come from, you know, come at you in an interesting way. You know, they don't as much feel like they might overpower you. You know, in Left 4 Dead, even the most basic zombie can crawl most vertical surfaces, and you know, if you're like inside of a small house trying to hold out, you know, they're gonna tear through some of the ceiling, they're gonna break in through windows, and you know, all this stuff. And in this, yeah, that just not really, like, I can tell in some levels they actually did kind of try to do that. Like, they appear to break something in the ceiling and then come through there, but yeah, it doesn't even remotely have the same effect. And in, you know, I didn't encounter a lot of low gravity levels, but in those you can pretty much just float over enemies, especially early on. When you start caring a lot, it can be a little harder. But yeah, you know, I mean, they can hop slightly, which actually makes them harder to take seriously when you see them do that, but yeah. And as others have noted, the mobs tend to be either too easy or too hard. As some have noted, the AI is, you know, lol, I'm here, shoot me dead. It's, yeah, they don't really act as though they are, like, yeah. And they tend to move fairly slowly, and they don't, like, taunt or something. They don't, yeah, you know, other than the actual threat they do represent, they're not that threatening. And the enemies do have friendly fire, which I didn't get around to, you know, I didn't spend a lot of time playing on the very highest of difficulty settings in this, but I want to say that there's also friendly fire there, but, excuse me, the enemies, even on the lowest of settings, the enemies have friendly fire, excuse me, and, yeah, if, like, it'll often happen with, like, bloat, like, if, when he thinks he's close enough to you, he'll start, you know, vomiting the bile, and if there are enemies around him, which there often are, they will take someone, even if you're, you know, if you manage to get away before he hits you, and yeah, someone will just turn around on, you know, face him, and then start attacking him, and he'll attack back. This has at least 33 weapons. That includes 6 assault rifles, including the Bullpup, Scar, and Fal. You'll forgive me, I know all these guns by their name, but I don't actually know how to pronounce it, because I don't usually, yeah, I don't usually say them out loud or hear others mention them, but yeah. And the, you know, you've got 6 shotguns, including the HSG-1, the AA-12, a nail gun with spread, 4 rifles, including an auto-loading crossbow with a scope, of course, the M14 EBR, and the M99 AMR. If you don't know these by name, you know, open a tab with Wiki, and you'll see, you know, that I'm choosing to only mention the names because the people who are especially into these games know exactly what these guns are. And that is decidedly what this is, who this is made for. 3 grenade launchers, including an M32 that properly lobs the grenades, a pipe bomb, which you throw to the ground very close to you and then acts as a proximity mine, and it doesn't blow up the first time someone gets close to it. It waits until a lot, or at least the most powerful, you know, some of the most powerful zombies are within its blast radius, and then blows up. 4 medical guns, which are basically SMGs and ARs, but with an alternate fire that heals your allies, and all of them recharge separately, so you can heal a lot, you know, within a short space of time. If, like, 3 players around you need healing, you know, just switch between the different guns. You can carry 3 of these at a time because they don't weigh all that much. And, you know, a number of the guns do have alternate fire, and, you know, it can be switching between semi-automatic and fully automatic. It can be changing between wide and tight spread for shotguns. You can dual wheel. If you have 2 pistols of the same kind, whether you buy a second or pick up or whatever, yeah, you can dual wheel that, and that goes for all 4 sets of pistols. And you can also sell them off one at a time. So, you know, if you're dual wielding something but you want the extra space, or you don't, you know, whatever, you want to sell just one of the pistols, you know, just click the dual, click sell, it'll sell the first one. That does also get annoying that you can't sell both at the same time, but Yeah. And these pistols do include a 44 Magnum and a Desert Eagle. You can also throw away the second one, which is useful for, you know, if you just can't get to the store to get rid of it, or you want to share it with one of your allies. Yeah. And there are some fire weapons as well, including, which also about, I think that's four as well, a MAC-10 and a shotgun with fire ammo, a flamethrower, and the fireball launcher that the zombie, the husk, was also carrying. It's literally called the husk fireball launcher, you know. Yeah, husk fireball, something around. It's definitely called the husk, and it's from the husk, and you can recognize it. And the fire weaponry really is an element that stands out in this game. You know, there's not really anything like it in Left 4 Dead. In Left 4 Dead, it's really just, you know, you can throw Molotovs, and you can blow up, you know, gas cans and such. But, you know, you can't carry something around that just, you know, over and over can be used to set fire. You know, and there's the incendiary ammo. But, yeah. You know, Contagion doesn't have anything like it. Dead Island doesn't go very far in this direction. Burning enemies with the flamethrower is way more fun than it should be. Just, you know, seeing the flesh of these zombies char and them coming apart. Yeah, that's... And, you know, seeing them walk while on fire is also quite enjoyable as the fire does its damage. And as they, you know, recoil in, you know, from taking the damage. And the flamethrower can actually throw these flames fairly far. And it also briefly sets the ground on fire. Admittedly, some of... You know, my praise of the fire weaponry in this, you know, is in part, I did just play Dead Space, and the fire weaponry is in that is pretty meh. And, you know, it's the game isn't really about fire weaponry. It's about you, it's more focused on kind of, you know, cutting and shooting apart. So it's, but nevertheless, it does have a flamethrower, and yeah, and comparatively, Bioshock's flamethrower is much better, and its grenade launcher is also better than the fire weaponry of Dead Space, and the grenade launcher in System Shock 2 is also better. You know, play to your strengths is what I'm saying. There are six melee weapons, including a machete, a katana, a chainsaw, and a large medieval sword. All of them, and the knife, can be quite useful against zombies, you know, for this kind of close-up, you know, you can do much more damage than you might think. You know, when I say, you know, oh, you can run around and just hack at enemies with, you know, you might think, well, that's just crazy talk, but it can actually be incredibly useful. The sword does a lot of damage. And some of the melee weapons have an alternate fire of a slower and more damaging attack. One of the melee weapons is a chainsaw, and it's of course one of the most, you know, powerful ones, and the chainsaw just is not anywhere near as good as the one from Left 4 Dead 2. I'm not certain which had the chainsaw before the other, but nevertheless, it's, you know, they came out the same year. It's impossible not to compare, and yeah, just the design is so much better in Left 4 Dead 2. You know, in both it can get loud, but in Left 4 Dead 2 you can't just use it forever, and it also isn't as loud when you just have it out. In this, it's loud even if you just have it out. And really, yeah, just, you know, I find the moment that it's like, okay, I can afford the chainsaw, and I buy it, and just the moment that you've bought it, it starts being loud, and I just find you usually just run around ready to switch to the chainsaw when it becomes necessary. But if you aren't surrounded by enemies, you might have another weapon out just so you don't have to listen to that noise all the time. And this might seem unfair to some, but given that this does make such, you know, do so much with, you know, that you can actually run around doing first-person perspective melee here. It's not, you know, it's not just the knife that you, of course, have. No, you can actually run around. There's a perk for it. So, you know, I have to compare. And this just has nothing on chivalry, which I haven't even spent that many hours playing, but, you know, a free weekend here and there. And, yeah, you know, and honestly, Contagion fares fairly well in that, and Dead Island does better than this, and I was pretty disappointed with the melee in Dead Island. You know, Left 4 Dead 2 doesn't go very far in the direction of first-person perspective melee, so, you know, it's not as fair to compare that to the, you know, but nevertheless, you know, it is more satisfying than the melee in this. And, you know, the chainsaw also, you know, when you're sawing through enemies, that I already mentioned that the, you know, the gibbing is a lot better in Left 4 Dead 2. I've just, yeah, you know, when you take a chainsaw to enemies, you know, in this, like, that's somewhere where Doom does a lot better than this. Just the feeling of just, yeah, tearing through these things. And that, again, Left 4 Dead 2 captures that really well. Now, you always have the default weapons of the knife and the 9mm. And, you know, when you have a melee weapon out, you can move faster. And movement speed is also determined by the weight system. The more you're carrying, the slower you're going to move. But nevertheless, bringing out a melee weapon, even if you're, yeah, it will still make you move faster. But, yeah, so, you know, you can carry a lot of small weapons or a few big ones or a mix of, you know, of small and big. You know, like, if you're running around with pistols, I want to say you can dual wield. Is it all four at once? So, you know, I mean, that's running around with 8 pistols, you know, so, yeah. Or you can run around with, like I said, 3, you know, relative, you know, medium-sized kind of rifles or submachine guns, or, you know, really, really big, yeah. Now, throwables, regardless of the perk, you have grenades, but there's a slight, you know, variety. The medic's grenades have these, you know, it releases this kind of gas which hurts enemies and heals you and your allies. So if, like, you are surrounded by enemies and taking damage, you can throw, you know, a few grenades to the ground, and that will do a lot to even the odds. And the, you know, there's of course some more, you know, it's an incendiary grenade for the, yeah, and I believe that the demolitions one is a more powerful grenade, but I forget. This has a weapons trader where you can buy and sell, and the store moves right at the start of a wave. You know, it when a new wave starts, the store closes, and then she moves somewhere else. And this does, you know, part of this is to make sure that the players don't just camp in one place the entire level, but, you know, it can still lead to, you know, once you get close to the store, you can more or less just camp there. But again, I didn't find that was too much the case. Maybe a third of the time or so. And there will be an arrow pointing to the store during the entire wave, so you can, you know, whether or not you're close to it. I do think if they were very worried about camping, I think that maybe if the entire team went very close to the store and then camped there, maybe the store could move during the wave as well, you know, something. Or yeah, maybe if they camp anywhere, some kind of, like, you know, I guess if they're not that close to the store, it doesn't necessarily make sense to move it, but I don't know, maybe do something to force at least some of the players to, you know, move a little, or, you know, maybe split up. That can sometimes be very useful, but also very dangerous, of course. I forget the game, but I played a multiplayer first-person shooter game. It was like, it was deathmatch or team deathmatch or something, and if you stood still for a few seconds, you would literally, the game would kill you for that. So even like, you couldn't like wait around a corner or something. No. You move or you die. And that's how you keep, that's a good incentive to keep players moving. Now, when a wave has ended and the store opens, there's also this, you know, kind of red floating kind of, you know, floating flying arrow that points to more or less, supposedly, the quickest, most direct route to the trader. And the trader, like I said, will only be open for a specific amount of time, and if, you know, if you run out of time, if you don't even get to the store before it closes, that's, you know, that's it. Then you just don't get to use the store that round. And I do really appreciate that, you know, in this, it is an actual, you physically have to move into, you know, it'll often be a room you move into, and there is, you know, everybody, every player can be in that same room at the same time, and it's, yeah, you know, you're not like waiting for someone to finish shopping and then leave. No. And I also really appreciate that if you're like, if you have to reload or maybe heal yourself or someone else, then you can start at doing that and then go into the store, and it will keep doing that as you're inside the store. And selling guns back, you know, it's not going to give you all the money back, but it, you know, she might give you a pretty decent deal. And when you die, it doesn't matter, you know, what weapons you had or anything, you go back to the default. You keep your money, but that's it. I found that due to generous co-op partners, I was able to try all the non-DLC guns very early. In less than 3 hours, I had tried out all of the different ones. And, you know, after that, yeah, it's kind of like, you know, yeah, it'd be cool to use some of them, again, including some of the most expensive ones. But at the end of the day, I have just tried everything that there was to try as far as just the guns themselves. And, you know, others have pointed out Why is she selling them? Why, you know, it's the zombie apocalypse. Why doesn't she keep any gun that she can? And you know, someone goes, oh, but it's because you are protecting her. She, you know, she has the guns, but she maybe can't use them for whatever reason. Not, you know, not necessarily sexism or something. Just, you know, she's a store owner, she's not a warrior, whatever. Then why isn't she giving them to you for free? What is she even using the money for? You know, it's. I feel like they could very easily have. And how are you earning money? By killing. Is the idea that you're robbing corpses or so, you know, just. And I don't feel like it had to. It could have easily made much more sense. Like, how about if she was like researching, and you know, either researching weapons that would be especially effective against the zombies, or maybe a cure for the zombieism, and you killing helps her research. You know, either it shows, okay, if you know, if I set it on fire, it does this and that, this amount of damage. If I shoot it, you know, I want to say it's Bioshock 2, where you have to start the camera and then use different guns on the enemy, you know. Something like that. And, you know, or maybe it helps on, you know, helps with the cure because, you know, she sees, you know, maybe, I don't know, maybe you bring back DNA to help, you know, I don't know exactly. Or, but just, yeah, something like that. Maybe as she's developing, you know, either the weapons or the cure, you know. You know, maybe it's that she comes to trust you more as she sees that, yeah, you really are here to kill the zombies. You're not gonna, you know, I don't know, try to start a street gang and take over the world now that it's every man for himself. You know, maybe she trusts you more. Maybe she gives you access to guns that are already there. Yeah. And, you know, she also will, you know, speak London. And you know, she'll say things like, I tool you up just right. And I'm like, right what? Right essay? And you know, she'll say, you know, once you've killed them all, come get me, which just makes me wonder what the ratings were on America's Funniest Divorce Videos. And you know, she'll assert their guns, you know what to do with them, and that's yeah. I understand why it's not just written but also spoken, but when you're, you know, when you're in the store and you if you click on something that you can't currently get, whether it's because it's, you know, it's too heavy compared to what you're already carrying or the money, the thing is, it doesn't show you how much it weighs without you clicking on it, and then she's going to say, nope, that's too heavy. Or, you know, maybe you click on something that you can't currently afford, but you know, and every single time they feel the need to play some sound bite of her explaining what it, and I just feel like I can read. And it's, this isn't like some, you know, again, this isn't sexism. I have a substantially greater tolerance for, like, you know, women being obnoxious than for guys being obnoxious. I would hate it way more if if it was some, like, you know, macho guy selling the weapons and responding and that kind of, yeah. But nevertheless, I just feel like, yeah, you know, I can read what the problem is. I just, you know, if they felt the need to, maybe just like underline either your current cash, you know, situation or the weight kind of thing. But I guess the idea is that you're supposed to just memorize what every single thing weighs and immediately, and just, I don't know. I guess if I kept playing it for much longer, then eventually I would memorize every single one of them, but just until I do, I really hate that. Yeah. Not every weapon has a flash. In fact, not very many weapons have flashlights on them. But if you just, you know, the 9mm, and it's adorable. When you have two 9mm, the game will pretend like there's a light on both. When, you know, when you turn it on, the animation will show him turning, you know, turning on both guns, but there's clearly just the one light. The one light that comes on when he presses it on one of the two guns. And it's just like, you know, I want to take a snapshot of that and put it up on the refrigerator just for effort. But nevertheless, there are a couple of other guns, and regardless of the current situation, you can always just press, you know, I think it defaults to F, just flashlight, quick flashlight, I think the function is called. And the, yeah, he'll immediately switch to, I think it is basically the most powerful gun he currently has that has a flashlight, and then he'll turn on the flashlight on that one. And yeah, that can be incredibly useful if you're very suddenly in a very dark place, or just, yeah. And others have noted that, you know, they didn't do this right away, but eventually Tripwire did, you know, go for pay-to-win DLC, and that really sucks. But, you know, you can play it without getting any DLC, and I do think that it's noteworthy, at least, that it's not like, it wasn't from right away. They didn't, you know, they got greedy somewhere along the way, but yeah. Both you and enemies can sometimes become stun-locked. Healing and welding can be done basically infinitely. It just needs to recharge. And the tactical aspect here is that you can't shoot while you're healing or welding. And welding especially, that means you're standing still and not shooting and looking specifically at what you're welding. So yeah, that, you know, you're gonna want someone to cover you while that happens. And you don't want every player to suddenly think, oh, now it's my turn, you know, now I have to weld, or okay, now I cover while the others weld, you know, yeah. And the, you know, basically, you can, I think to heal yourself, you need to have it at 100, but to heal others, I think it, even at just like 75, you can, you know, heal someone else. And this does mean that you can, you know, as it recharges, you can heal someone else, then someone else again, maybe yourself then, in a relatively short amount of time. But again, means you can't be, you know, and thankfully, right away, it looks like it takes forever for him to put the needle back away. The moment that you've actually healed, just press, you know, one of the weapons keys, and he will switch away from it, and it will become ready afterwards. You know, it's you don't actually have to hold, you know, have to have the thing out for them. Yeah. And basically, when you are welding, you basically, it can weld once it's out of charge, unlike the healing, but it's going to be much slower. And yeah, it can, you know, maybe it makes more sense to wait a few seconds before you weld again to let it recharge. And every perk has, you know, you start out at level 0 and the maximum is level 6. And yeah, it's, you know, basically the different perks, a lot of these are going to be self-explanatory. The medic, you know, the support specialist uses shotguns and is responsible for welding, and he can also carry more. The sharpshooter, the commando, can see the invisible units from, you know, a little bit of distance, and can see how much health enemies have, so he can be really useful for, you know, telling the others who to, you know, which zombies to shoot and such. The berserker is the melee one. The firebug is basically mob control. And if you go to his house, note that Beth overdrinks. Demolitions is self-explanatory as well. And as there are 7 perks and only 6 players, you can't cover all the different perks. So it is a matter of, you know, in addition to everyone having to, you know, figure out which perk should I be, or, you know, maybe it's a team decision who gets which perk. Ultimately, you have to, you know, at the very end, it will come down to which of these perks, you know, you have to unselect one of them, you might say. Select against, I don't know. And that is something, there's nothing like perks in Left 4 Dead or Contagion, so that's, you know. And to be fair, Dead Island is much more of a role-playing game than this, so the fact that that is much more elaborate than this is not really a point against this game. You know, if you want, you know, a role-playing game with this kind of zombies, then yeah, you go for that, obviously, rather than this. The various tactics are covered fairly well with, you know, with the different perks. Some have noted that, you know, after a fun first 2 hours, it does become a grind fest, and yeah, when you typically to get to the next level of a perk, you have to kill so and so many enemies or do so and so much damage. And between one of the levels and the next level in a perk, it might say, okay, do this 30 times. And then once you've gotten, you know, done those, then it'll say, okay, now do it 100 times. And this is the kind of thing that can really make you realize how much of a grind it is. And some people are just going to straight up quit the moment that they see, you know, okay, now I'm supposed to do it 100 more times, you know. And it's not even that you get access to new guns, or it refines the skills that the perk represents. You know, I get that it's, you know, it's in part because there are so few levels. You know, I find that I haven't played that many role-playing games, but I do find that it's a good idea to have more levels so that it can be more of a gradual rise, rather than that it's just incredibly, it takes you forever to get from one level to another. Just, you know, start out with it being fairly easy to, well, to be fair, at the very start, it is very easy to get from, it's easy in this to get from rank 0 to rank 1 in a lot of them. But nevertheless, you know, just stay in the relatively small and just give a little bit to the player when they reach a new rank, and then gradually. But as it is here, yeah, if you don't love playing it and or you don't really like grinding, yeah. Now, as someone noted, it basically has the opposite of a difficulty curve with, you know, basically the higher level, you know, yeah, the players who have higher levels of perks are going to kill more zombies, and that means they're going to earn the money, they're going to have them, they're going to be able to buy the bigger guns, unless, you know, sometimes they are generous, but honestly, I found, yeah, again, probably about a third of the time, the, you know, your teammates are going to be fairly generous. Otherwise, not necessarily. At the end of the day, the game doesn't really punish you if you don't share. So, you know, I can respect that it does. Like, in Left 4 Dead, if you just simply do not go around and help up the in-capped, if you do not cover the others, if you do not play it cooperatively, you're going to be kicked. Because the other players, that's hugely going to affect how the match plays out. And in this, you know, they can play a bunch of waves, and, you know, some players that don't do as well will come in, and maybe they'll stay for a few rounds hoping that, but nope, they're not earning the money, they're not getting the money, so they might quit. That's not really going to affect the experience for the more, you know, experienced players, because someone else might just come in and they, yeah. Anyway, if most of the players in a match are all new, then it might be more, you know, that's maybe kind of the idea, that you play within your own kind of, that every player in a certain match is roughly on the same level, so that, yeah. But, you know, and this same problem is when you join a match, especially late in, you know, if it's just a few waves in, you're going to be stuck with tiny guns, which are not right for the job, and just, if you had just one, you know, just one more gun, like, let's say you join wave 2 or 3, just one more gun, one that's slightly higher level than what you have, or maybe just a little bit more money, because when you start out, like, you'll typically start with maybe 250 or 300 pounds, of course, not dollars, and that's really not enough for much of anything. Like, you can buy a second 9mm, or you can maybe buy, like, you can buy more ammo or more grenades, or you can buy this lever action rifle, but that's it. There's nothing else you can't even live up to your perk for the first couple of waves until you get the money, or you find the weapons, or someone gives you the money or gives you the weapons, you know. If you're a berserker, you're gonna run around just with a knife, but yeah, a lot of them do, the perks rely on you having gotten some weapon that fits that particular perk. I should briefly note, when you buy weapons, you can buy any weapons that you want, basically, but the perk you've selected is going to be the first screen of weapon. You can click away, you can click to the others. It's just, you know, the game is maybe kind of, you're maybe supposed to get guns within, you know, it's really very segregated in that way, that, yeah, you get the guns that fit your perk, in, you know, the, so that you can do what the, you know, because when the other players see your perk, they're going to expect you to do what that perk, you know, you're supposed to be the best at what you do, and yeah. And I should also briefly note, whenever you check the current score, you can, you know, when you know, with the names of your allies, there's also their current health, their current wealth, and the, you know, the perk they've selected, and their level in that perk. so that you can, yeah, you know, all of that is incredibly useful information. Now, honestly, the way I see it, it would be easy to fix this issue of, you know, money and weapons and just if you earned, or this would do a lot at least. If you earned by how much damage you do, not only how much, you know, when you kill, because if you're, you know, if you're running around with just your 9mm and your knife, you know, you can be doing damage to these zombies, but then, you know, one of the other players on the team are gonna blow them up or set them on fire or something, and that's gonna, you know, your assists really don't do this, and it just, if you earned by that, or maybe, I don't know, or just if there were other ways, you know, if it's really early in, you know, if you don't have a lot, I forget which philosopher who said that, you know, no matter what, even if you're not necessarily, you know, you be the best at what you are. Even if you can't afford or you don't have anything bigger yet, like, just, yeah, you know, I don't know, I guess you do still start out with grenades, and, you know, you can run around healing with just the injection and welding and such, you know, if, yeah, like that, and that does help some. I believe, maybe it's only the medic, I'm not certain if you earn by healing others, but yeah, just maybe just more starting cash. It's just, yeah. And honestly, if you're in a long match and it goes really well, again, I didn't spend that much time playing the very highest difficulties, but even, yeah, you might end up with way more money than you'll ever need. And yeah, you know, you might end up just like throwing money back and forth at each other, or juggling, which you do by aiming upwards but also angling right, because the money kind of arcs. So yeah, I admit that there are worse games to play, but still, it's, you don't have to pay for the guns every round. And I do think that when you're especially rich, when it's going to, yeah, you know, the game maybe should make you buy the same guns again or something, you know. And, you know, because it's not like you can, as you make more and more money, you can buy more weapons to carry. Once you have as many as you can carry, you know, then it doesn't, yeah, and I'm not saying it should, but yeah, you know, one thing you can do is just go to another, you know, go for one of the other perks and then sell the guns you have right now and buy big guns for that other perk. But yeah, you know, and that isn't necessarily, like, you can play a long match with, you know, six of the different perks represented and no one ever switching perk and it going well. So, you know, it's not, the game isn't made for you to go between the different perks in a single match like that. One thing that you can do if you have a ton of money is you can keep buying pipe bombs and, you know, drop them very close to the store, you know, since otherwise you wouldn't be able to get back and forth. But, you know, that's not gonna do that much. Like, you know, then you can try to lure enemies close to the store there, but yeah. And as others have noted, the early, you know, like the warm-up waves do get tedious. You know, you kind of want to get to the part where it's more fun. And again, especially considering that the warm-up waves may not even lead to you having a ton of, like, yeah, having a ton of money and being able to buy all the big guns and such. Now, the automatic taunts that the, you know, your character and others will do occasionally repeat. Like the first time you see one of the, you know, the spiders, crawlers, you know, maybe you see it hop, and your character will say, and they hop too, you know, kind of, you know, as if it wasn't bad enough. And then a little later, when he sees another crawler not hopping, he might say, do they hop, or something, you know, don't tell me they hop too, or like, and yeah, it's just, I mean, this didn't happen hugely often, but it takes you out of it a little bit. And you will sometimes run into just, yeah, you know, co-op players that aren't that good. I think it's, again, it's roughly a third of the time that I've played that I've run into players who just aren't that good at it, and that's obviously undesirable. Not making them undesirables. The only mutators that the game like starts out with is just a series of, okay, only this enemy will spawn, and just, yeah, I just feel like that's not a lot. And when you get to, you know, the server screen, you can thankfully mark it to not show matches that are full, matches that are empty, that, you know, that don't have the anti-cheat thing, that, you know, and the, you know, or are password protected. And honestly, I don't think, I'm not sure there was ever really a time where there weren't at least 10 servers and any, you know, yeah, when I checked to play, which, you know, is not counting all the ones that were full or the ones that were empty. So depending on how long you want to wait, or if you maybe have, you know, a group of friends to play with, then you can start one by yourselves. And, you know, when you join, you will typically, pretty much always, unless it is just, you know, if the match is currently between waves, then you'll join during that. But otherwise, you will have to wait for the current wave to end, and yeah, that can take minutes, and that's, again, a little annoying. You can select perk once per wave, and though you can see the, you know, you can see the one that other players currently have, but you can't see the new one until right after they change it. So yeah, at least a couple of times I experienced that I and someone else would both switch, you know, both of us expect, you know, yeah, you could communicate your way out of that, but not everybody's going to communicate with. So yeah, I just feel like if, the thing is that if you tell it to change perk during a wave, it will tell you, okay, at the end of this wave you will become this, but it's not going to tell anybody else. And again, this is an easy fix. Just put it on when you know, check, you know, press tab to see scores and such. Just show, okay, this is the person's current perk, this is the perk that they've selected to, you know, because yeah, as it is, I experienced where I and someone else, we were both firebugs, and then both of us figured, I'll just switch to demolitions, and then suddenly there were two demolitions instead of two firebugs. Yeah. As others have noted, this is one of the best co-op games. It has a pretty good quick voiceover menu, not the level of the Left 4 Dead one, but, you know, Basically, it's the number keys. I think it's all 1 to 5. I didn't check every single one, but yeah. And some have encountered other players being jerks to new players. I haven't experienced that. But then, you know, it's out there. But just so you know, there are sometimes weapons randomly spawned across the level. You can share money, and healing is more effective on other players than on yourself. When you weld a door shut, basically means that most of the zombies are going to go in a different direction. A few are going to stay and keep attacking. This is basically the same as the boards in Contagion, which, you know, when I played Contagion, I didn't know that, but yeah, this is where Contagion got that idea, definitely. Just, you know, the difference is that in this you don't need boards. The door, you know, can be fixed. I'm not sure it always does, but it certainly can be fixed at the end of a wave. You know, respawns automatically so that it's there again. And if you, you know, if you don't weld a door at all, then the zombies can just straight up open it. And you can see your allies' names through walls if you're close enough. The welder has to recharge, and, you know, the if one player's welder is recharging, they can just swap out, you know, they can bring out the gun, and then someone else can go in with their welder. I believe I already mentioned, but otherwise, if you try to weld while it's recharging, it will still weld, but it's going to do it slower, and anytime you're welding, it's not recharging, or recharging slower, I suppose you could say. And the welding is the only interesting skill, and honestly, Contagion does do it better. There are more entrances. You can't really fix it during, so, you know, basically you have to, if you want to put new boards up, you have to remove them or leave, you know, or just wait until the enemy has destroyed them, and then you have to make sure that there are no enemies, you know, coming in through the entrance, because they're going to block you. Yeah, you know, you have to stand there for a few seconds, and as you do so, it's not that you put up the boards and then you finish. No, the boards come up after you've stood there for a few seconds putting the boards up. You know, you can choose to shoot through the boards, but that's going to damage them. You can shoot between them, but that's a much smaller window to shoot through. You can only carry 4 boards at a time. It's just more compelling. And often when a new game improves on an element in an even slightly older game, it's typically because of technology. But here, they could have done it better. And I'm not saying that it has to be as complex as Contagion, but when you introduce an element, it's do something with it, you know, have it be at least a little interesting. I've been in countless matches where nobody ever even welds anything. There are tons of maps where there isn't really that much to even weld, and just, yeah. The graphics are just okay. And like Contagion, it's quite a challenging game. You know, like, no matter how easy or hard a difficulty you play on, like Left 4 Dead, you can play that even if you're a little new to the game. But this and Contagion, nah. If you don't have this, you know, the basic skills of first person shooting and co-op down, you're going to have trouble. And, you know, the higher difficulties require really good teamwork in this. And, you know, there are 5 difficulty settings. And much like the Hobo Theater, each is different. there are 19 main maps, and they include this kind of, you know, a creepy Christmas setting or two, a dance club, a laboratory that's kind of underground, a carnival, this kind of hillbilly setting, a steampunk kind of carnival. I just repeated myself. Apologies. A space station. Originally, there were apparently only a few, but then, you know, more came in through updates. You don't have to use mod ones to, you know, if you don't want to download any mods. There are servers just with the regular maps and with no mods on them. Levels are often, you know, quite big and open. A number of levels have invisible borders, which basically do mean that I've never seen in this game someone dying from an endless fall. You can die from fall, you know, there's fall damage, so you can die if you take a steep drop, but I didn't encounter one where you could actually die if you had full health, although I did not try all of them. And there are a lot of areas to, you know, different angles and such to fend off zombies, so all six players can, you know, be really valuable at all times, usually. When I last checked, there were 1,852 mods. And, you know, when you go to download maps, do note that a number of them, it is, you know, it's music for maps. And this, of course, includes some metal, and, you know, there's System of a Down. I'm probably going to mispronounce this because I've never heard of, I don't really do music. Cell Dweller and Blue Stolly. Rammstein? No, them, of course. Rammstein. I'm close enough to Germany to, yeah. Skrillex, Metallica, Lady Gaga, soundtracks of games and movies such as Alien, Tekken, The Matrix, Silent Hill, Portal 2, Mass Effect, the Street Fighter franchise. There's one called Techno Tetris that I didn't get around to listening to. And, you know, there are 450 mutators, 88 story, 149 game types, 759 multiplayer, 149 competitive, 273 gameplay ones, 210 alternate skins. Including Boba Fett, Deadpool, Shrek, Dead Space, various guns, 481 miscellaneous, 174 art, 276 weapons, which of course include military ones, 700 single player, 545 co-op, 132 features, 181 user interface, 67 waves, 197 Zeds, 90 creatures, 76 total conversions, 198 characters, 82 clothes, gear, 90 tools, 12 vehicles, and a partridge in a pear tree. The Unreal Engine does, of course, come with its strengths and weaknesses. When you join a server that has mods or levels you don't have, it is entirely capable of downloading those. However, you know, and it'll show the, you know, how much it's, you know, needs to download, and it has a percentage counter, but that's only for the current one, not all of them. And yeah, it can take minutes on end to just download all this stuff, and it doesn't show you before you join. I mean, when the level name, if you know every single level you have, I don't, then, you know, by name, then you can see, okay, that's, even if it has like a letter or a number in there that's not, then it might be a different version and there's going to be downloading, and, you know, it might be a level that you have but have mods and such. So yeah, one mod I played allowed for 30 players at a time. And there's currently 884 listed as maps, but it's really more like 855 actual maps. I have 81 for just, you know, regular mode, the 9 for gun game, 1 for objective, and 1 for, you know, downloaded ones, and 1 for story. There's apparently a limit to, you know, once you have 50 subscribe, you know, once you subscribe to 50 different mods or levels or whatever, that's where it ends. But it doesn't tell you this. It, you know, when you click for the 51st one, it doesn't tell you you have to unselect some of these. So I didn't know this. So I subscribed to basically all 855 maps, and yeah, like I said, I ended up with just these, you know, 82, I guess. Yeah. And I haven't been able to remove. I'll admit, I didn't try every single thing because I'm not the biggest fan of, like, going in and fiddling with the basic. I kind of feel like a game, you know, you should basically be able to play it without being a computer wizard. And yeah, I didn't want to risk screwing something up with the game. So, but unsubscribing to maps doesn't necessarily mean that the game removes them and adds another map. So yeah, and that's, yeah, I really wish they, I hope they fix that at some point, somehow. The only other game that I've downloaded mods for on Steam is Rack, and, you know, I went back to check, but was there a 50, because with Rack, I know I got absolutely everything. You know, not everything. There were a couple that didn't work. Did I end up unsubscribing? Anyway, if I'm almost certain there's like 49 mods for that. So yeah, that doesn't reach the 50 limit, and I can understand why more people mod this. Although, honestly, I mean, if I'm gonna come back for a mod in either game, it would probably be Rack. If I'm gonna reinstall one of these two games in a month from now, and I, you know, now that I've reviewed this game, I'm probably not gonna keep playing it. It's just not quite varied enough. The way that I kept playing Left 4 Dead, it's been a little while since I really sat down and played Left 4 Dead or Contagion. But once I started playing them, I kept playing them for a long time because there's just more variety to it. Now, the maps are not all equally big or serious or professional, but yeah, the majority of the ones I played were fun. They cover franchises such as Doom, Resident Evil, Silent Hill, Alien, The Walking Dead, Night of the Living Dead, Shaun of the Dead, Friday the 13th, and other inspirations for this, and of course also others such as, you know, other, you know, franchises that didn't necessarily directly inspire this: Minecraft, Wolfenstein, Half-Life, Blue Shift, Pirates of the Caribbean, or is it Caribbean, whatever, Dojo, Mario, excuse me, Duke Nukem, Deus Ex, Halo, Road to Perdition for some reason, Portal, Helm's Deep, Metal Gear Solid, Afghanistan, Postal 2, the, you know, the Lost Boys, Mos Eisley, Spaceport, Mortal Kombat 2, GoldenEye 64, the classic, Zelda, Counter-Strike, The Clue Mansion, Cabin Fever, an army base, D-Day and other World War II, the Wild West, old Persian temple, you know, or ancient Persian temple, ancient city and, you know, buildings, old and new, forest, the Red Square. Large corporate office building, the biological labs, of course, space station, industry buildings, beach, Lego, Dragon Ball, pyramid, Kithon, Elder God Temple, various temples, caves, Arctic outposts, ancient tombs, and the like. Icebreaker is a level where it's literally a ship out at sea during this horrible storm in this, like, you know, and if you see the ship rock and don't come knock and rather send help because people are dying. And it really seems like it's inspired by Cold Fear. I couldn't quite get confirmation on that, but it really reminded me of that. And yeah, it genuinely is rocking just like in that game. So that's really cool. And, you know, there'll be corpses strewn about in some of these levels. What species? Pick one. You know, clearly something has gone wrong here. You know, it might be overrun. Maybe there's signs of murder, torture, cooking, and eating of various species, including humans. One level, I believe this was actually one of the official ones. Yeah, I want to say it's the farm level. There's actually a carcass of a cow on fire. I don't know, maybe that only stood out to me as especially, but just, that's messed up. And yeah, just, you know, places that make sense to have overrun by the undead, or places that really don't make sense to have overrun by the undead. You know, supernatural, sci-fi. You know, when I first heard that this was made by Tripwire and Rank, I wasn't surprised when I first found out that there was a game like this. You know, that there were others than Left 4 Dead and Contagion, Dead Island and such. The core, and that is something, again, this game does do things that those games do not. There's definitely, like, yeah, this definitely has its audience. And, you know, so I wasn't surprised to find out that it existed, but I was pretty surprised to find out that it was made by the same people who made the Red Orchestra games. And really, I suppose, I mean, you can tell it's the same engine, but, you know, obviously. But really, and you know, they're both fiercely tactical games, but it's especially just the dedication to making the like, again, I've gone into points of criticism, things where I feel like they could have done more or such, but clearly this and both Red Orchestra games, these three are labors of love. These, you know, Tripwire Interactive really, really care about, you know, both of these franchises. They really want, you know, people to be satisfied with what they get.